Welcome to Stetson Law Live, an online, interactive, informational event for prospective students of Stetson University College of Law. On today's program, Assistant Dean Laura Zuppo and her guest, Dean and Professor of Law, Christopher Pietruszkiewicz. On today's program, a talk with the Dean.
I think as of right now, there are almost 50 folks signed in for this webinar. Today's topic is a talk with the Dean. And so I'd like to introduce myself and then our keynote, I guess, or our key interviewee of the day, Dean Pietruszkiewicz. So my name is Laura Zuppo. I'm the Assistant Dean of Strategic Enrollment Management here at Stetson. I've worked at Stetson for about a little over 15 years. I oversee the admissions functions, financial aid, scholarships, and veterans benefits. So we're definitely going to cover those topics today. And with me is Dean Pietruszkiewicz. Dean Pietruszkiewicz is here almost 5 years. It's getting on five years. So Dean, do you want to tell them a little bit about yourself, your background?
Sure, I'd be happy to. So welcome. Thank you so much for joining us. I have been at Stetson for 5 years, and it's been a fabulous experience. You know, we've seen so many changes going on in the world of legal education, and I'm delighted to say that Stetson has been doing extraordinarily well. My background is as a practicing attorney, and I think that that is influential, as all of our professors have had nearly 10 years of practice experience before they became law professors. And so mine was very similar to theirs before coming to academia, 17 years ago. I was a trial attorney for the United States Department of Justice in the tax division, so my client was the IRS. So as you can imagine, I was so well liked wherever I went. And I got a chance to travel the country, try cases on behalf of the government. Got to teach as an adjunct at George Mason's Law School during one semester while I was at the Justice Department. And then decided that this was something that I wanted to do full time, and have been doing it for 17 years, and Stetson has just been great.
It's wonderful. And I think students really do appreciate the fact that as a dean, you continue to teach. What are some of the courses that you teach, those fun courses?
So I teach, interestingly, I teach tax. So it's all tax all the time. Although this semester I'm teaching an accounting for lawyers class. You know, I think one of the things that law schools have done extraordinarily well since their inception, and for us that's, you know, that was founded in 1900, is we teach people about practicing law, but I'm not so sure that we've been so good about teaching students about the business of the practice of law. And so we have adjusted our curriculum to have more courses for those political science majors and philosophy majors that don't have a business background, but are ultimately going to go work in a law firm with 10 or 15 people. And the result is that they're going to become much more involved in the business of the practice of law much earlier in their career than they had perhaps in the past. And so the Accounting for Lawyers class is one that I developed 15 years ago that allows students who have a background that is not business-based to understand a little bit more about financial statements, income statements, balance sheets, statements of cash flow, understanding the time value of money, understanding how you structure settlements, understanding what contingencies are, and financial ratios that banks look at to help advise your clients and to help advise yourself on what banks are looking for when you're in business for yourself. So it's been a great experience. I remember when I was interviewing here, one of the questions that you almost always get as a dean candidate is, are you going to teach? And my answer was no in the first year, yes in the third year, and we'll see what happens in the second year. And so I have been teaching at least once a year ever since my second year at Stetson, in large part because I think we do lots of things as a law school. We do lots of things as an institution, but the most important thing that we do is teach. And so if I think the most important thing that we do is teach, I ought to do that myself. And so that's why I also spend some time in the classroom.
And I think that's important. Now, I know, folks, that a few of you have typed in that you're having some audio problems. We are working on it right now. And so if you can just holler at us with a chat response if it gets better, because we are working on it. So what's really exciting about this opportunity and for you all out there is, how often do you actually get to ask questions directly of a dean? of a dean of a law school, right? A faculty member, you know, those sort of inside scoop questions. And we have a whole bunch of them that you submitted. And I noticed that Carmen Johnson had you type in where you're from. And I see we have someone from El Paso. We have a couple of Tampa folks and some other folks. Thanks for telling us where you guys are located. For those of you who are up in the cold weather states, we wish you well with the pending snowstorm. I'm glad I'm surrounded here by palm trees. It's really a green screen, but it's pretty cool. All right, so let's take some of your questions. One of the things that I was really excited to see were so many questions from non-traditional students. You all identified yourself with a variety of titles, non-traditional, the over 40 crowd, second career, mature students. I like non-traditional. So when we think about our non-traditional students, the first thing I say is, you know, of course we have a part-time program, but not all of our non-traditional students want to be part-time students. Some want to be full-time students. Can you tell us a little bit about sort of how we incorporate the non-traditional student, and are there any negatives or positives with being a non-traditional?
I think from an institutional perspective, having a number of non-traditional students for us is really fantastic. You know, so before I became dean, I was a faculty member. And while I was a faculty member, I was also chair of an admissions committee. And whenever I looked at admissions files, I love to see that someone has had some real-world experiences before they came to law school, so that we know when we sit and we stand in front of a classroom of 20 people, 30 people, 40 people, 50 people, that there is a lot of interaction that happens with us in the classroom. But I think more importantly, there's a lot of interaction that happens outside of the classroom. And those discussions are not always guided by law professors. They're guided by the students themselves in study groups, when people get together to talk about what just happened in class. And I think that students are most influenced by those who are non-traditional students because they've had some of those real-world experiences. So when I served as chair of our admissions committee, one of my thoughts always was, has this person had some of those types of experiences, because they lend so much to the classroom discussion, and recognizing that Stetson very much fits that way, in large part because our students do have so much interaction with one another, and those real-world experiences do make a difference, whether in the classroom or outside the classroom.
Speaking of classroom, several of our viewers, I guess you want to say, wrote in about the curriculum is a 1L, and how are courses structured? How are they different from undergrad? We all hear about the Socratic method. Is it still used in the traditional format? Can you talk a little bit, Dean, about not just the traditional law school approach and how things have evolved in terms of assessments?
Sure. So, you know, a long time ago, Christopher Columbus Langdell, who was the dean of Harvard's law school, came up with the Socratic method as a way for learning that happens in a law school classroom. And while that still exists, which is a Socratic dialogue, a question and answer session back and forth between a law professor and students, I think that the evolution of law schools has completely changed. So if you've ever watched The Paper Chase, if you've read the book 1L, so many of those things have changed. You know, if you you step on campus at Stetson, I get an opportunity during orientation to welcome all of you to campus. And one of the things that I talk about during orientation is Paper Chase and 1L talk about look to your left and look to your right. One of those students isn't going to be with us when you graduate from law school. And I use a variety of that conversation and say look to your right and look to your left. One of them is going to help you get through law school. So I think the ways that we have thought about law school from the early 1970s, in late 1970s and early 1980s, when you had lots of people that came to law school thinking about it from a paper chase perspective, are very pleasantly surprised that law school, and particularly law school at Stetson, is very much a collaborative environment. And so the assessments are not just one exam at the end of the semester, which determines your grade for the semester. But there's collaborative work that happens between students in problems that exist in class and outside of class, that there are assessment tools that we use throughout the semester to help you get a better sense about how you're doing, And I think that leads into a discussion about our academic success program. So we have four dedicated full-time professionals that are here at Stetson to help you navigate your first year of law school, and then ultimately help you navigate the bar exam after you graduate from law school. And so we don't think about admitting people that we don't think are going to be successful in law school, and we don't think about admitting people that are not going to be successful on the bar exam. We're looking for people that add to our community environment, that are able to add to the intellectual discourse that is supposed to happen in a law school and on a law school campus. Ultimately, for people that are going to be proud alumni of Stetson when they graduate from law school. So the ways that people thought about law school in the 1970s are not the way that we approach law school in 2015, 2016, 2017. It is one that is much more collaborative. It is one that has assessments throughout your course of your law school career. And you'll find the professors are very welcoming for questions, particularly in your first year professors in your first year.
It's funny, I had a curriculum committee meeting earlier today, and Professor Roberta Flowers, who's well known for her work in advocacy and elder law, she talked about the importance of exam review and the fact that for her midterm, and she does do a midterm, she invites every single student to meet with her on a one-on-one basis to go over the exam so that they can improve in time for the final exam. And she talks about how so many of the students really just didn't know that they would have that one-on-one experience with a member of the faculty. We actually have such a few great questions that we've had posted, so I want to jump to those. And Carmen, if you would be so kind as to scroll up a little bit on the chat feature, we have a great monitor you guys can't see off screen. And one of you guys asked this great question about jobs, and it's a hot topic, right? We had a lot of folks actually type in career development, career placement, ask questions about stats. The first thing I want to tell you is that's a point of pride for Stetson. And before I ask the dean to jump in, for all of you who are trying to compare law schools and you're looking at apples to apples data, every law school is required to place on their ABA consumer disclosures page or career development pages their career stats, and they all look exactly the same. So as you're measuring schools and evaluating them, you should really pull those stats up. Carmen, if you would be Carmen is going to put a link to ours. So Dean, will you talk to the group a little bit about our approach to career development, some of the strengths, really, you know, what sets us apart maybe a little in that area?
Sure, Laura, I'm happy to. I think there are three important pillars that exist in a law school. One is its admissions program. Second is its academic success and bar preparation program. And third is their career development program. So how good are we at helping students find the types of jobs that they want and the reason why they came to law school in the first place? I'm delighted to say that our employment statistics that I'm hoping Carmen has provided a link on our chat feature, if you take a look at those, there's two really important blocks for you to take a look at. So the reason why you go to law school is really, is perhaps twofold. One is to get a job that is JD required, and second is to get a job that's JD preferred. The difference between the two is one is typically going to work for a law firm, to work for the state's attorney's office, the public defender's office. And the other is to go into work in business and industry in which your JD is not required, but having a JD is an advantage. A good example that I like to use is Rich McKay, who is the president of the Atlanta Falcons, is a Stetson Law graduate. And every time that I talk to him, he talks about the same thing with his JD Advantage degree. And he's not the general counsel for the Atlanta Falcons. He is the president of the Atlanta Falcons. But the critical thinking skills that he learned, that we learn, that we teach in law school has an impact every day on his work as being a president and not being a lawyer for a National Football League organization. So when you put those two together, and take a look at those two statistics, it seems to me that the marketplace is saying to Stetson, we value what you're producing in terms of lawyers and leaders in the community, and it's very reflective of our market position that exists. So we have not made significant changes to our curriculum Over the 5 years that I've been here, we've made some minor changes, some tweaks to our curriculum. And the, part of the reason why we haven't made those major changes is because the marketplace is valuing the types of students that graduate from Stetson. And so the significance and the success of our students, particularly in those JD required and JD advantage positions, puts us comparable to any other law school that exists in Florida.
And I have to just say, for a lighthearted comment, it looks like we have one of you guys commented that the dean looks all sharp with his salmon pocket square. And I have to agree. So whoever wrote that, thank you for that fun, lighthearted comment. I love things like that. All right, on a more serious note, Celeste has a question about some of our more popular areas of the law. And the question is Stetson popular for being successful in a particular area of law? And I would love to throw that at you, because I know we've talked over and over about some of the most important things attorneys can bring to the table.
So the thing that lawyers do when they graduate from law school, the things that lawyers do when they're in the middle of their career, and the things that lawyers do at the end of their career are really twofold. One is that they advocate on behalf of their clients orally in court. And second is they advocate on behalf of their clients on paper. And the two things that I think Stetson is best known for are its advocacy program and its legal writing program. So our advocacy program is one that has been ranked number one in the country by U.S. News and World Report for 18 of the last 20 years. That's pretty hard to do, because the people who vote on whether Stetson is the number one advocacy law school in the country are the people that teach advocacy at other law schools. We host an Educating Advocates Conference every summer, in which lawyers from across the country, law professors from across the country, and law professors across the world come to Stetson so that we teach people who teach advocacy how to teach advocacy. So it is significant, I think, to us that our students are so successful, particularly in the courtroom, after they graduate. One of the members of our Board of Overseers likes to say that someone who has gone through our trial team, our moot court, our alternative dispute resolution programs, now referred to as the dispute resolution program, essentially have 3 years of experience when they graduate from law school, in large part because of the training that happens as part of our advocacy program while you're in law school. Our legal writing program has never been outside of the top six in the United States in terms of its program, and a big part of that is because of the resources, the effort, and the fantastic professors that we have in that discipline. And one of the things that I often hear when I go to alumni events is that law students, when they graduate from law school, aren't able to write at the standard that they were hoping. I very seldomly hear that about a Stetson law student, in large part because of the time and effort and energy by our faculty in making sure that our students are very well prepared for practice when they graduate from law school. So I think, Laura, the combination of the two of those things, advocacy and legal writing, makes an enormous difference for Stetson graduates when they graduate from law school.
I agree. And just to give a little bit more information, for those of you thinking about a certificate of concentration, Stetson has a certificate of concentration in advocacy, elder law, international law, environmental law, and social justice advocacy. We also have a JD MBA and a JD MPH with the University of South Florida, as well as several JD LLM programs, JD LLM in advocacy, and a couple of international programs. We do have a question about concentrations for women rights and gender law. And I would say we don't have a particular concentration in that area, but there are significant courses as well as student organizations. We do have our public interest law area. If you look at our curriculum, you can see some of the courses there, and that would cover some of those topics. I think that's probably good on that, right? Okay, so we have two questions involving admissions, and I'd like to transition to that. Let's talk a little bit about the admissions process and the personal statement. So the first question is, how do we review applications? And the second is about the personal statement. And the first thing I will tell you about how we review files, and my time here at Stetson, I've read a lot of files. And Dean P, as we so lovingly refer to him, Dean P has read a lot of files. It's really fun. It's fun. it helps us get to know you. So please remember that those essays, those personal statements, if you attach an addendum explaining some kind of mishap, maybe a weak GPA, I think someone said in one of the questions that they had a poor semester early on in college life, but then did better. You know, when you explain things to us in written form, we read it and we think about it. We put it in context. I love having my double monitors, and I can have your transcript up in one and your personal statement up in the other, and I can get a sense of what was going on during your college years. Maybe have your resume up with your academic record. But Dean, you know, one of the things we talk about is a holistic file review. Do you want to expand more on that and talk a little bit about that philosophically and what it means to Stetson?
So we don't at Stetson think about students in terms of just LSAT scores and grade point averages. They are certainly influential in admissions decisions, but we don't make any decisions based simply on numbers. And so we like to think that we have a holistic approach to our admissions process. And so that takes into account grade point average, it takes into account grade trends, it takes into account LSAT scores, it also takes into account personal statements, it takes into account letters of recommendation. As well as any other things that you submit to us as part of the application process. So we're trying to figure out the whole person when someone applies to law school. We have another member of our board who says that when you graduate from law school, you're not just a graduate of law school, you're a Stetson lawyer when you graduate. And a big part of that is that holistic approach that we have in our admissions process is one that plays itself out when you graduate. And you're part of the Stetson community that exists while you're here for 3 years or 4 years if you're part of the part-time program, and really part of the Stetson family that exists long after you graduate from law school. And so the holistic approach helps us to get to know that person and helps us be able to shape our class so that it does feel like you're part of a community. Laura asked a little bit earlier about non-traditional students. That is a big part of the mix as we think about how we shape an overall portion of our class, so that we do have students that fit geographical diversity and ethnic diversity and racial diversity, socioeconomic diversity. All of those things play an enormous part as we think about the admissions process at Stetson.
And we've had a couple of folks ask more specific questions, I think, more about their experiences. Someone wrote in about being over 60 and partially disabled. Another candidate has written about being a veteran. Everyone's welcome to apply. We want applications that reflect the folks in our community. We have a fantastic ADA coordinator, so if we do have someone who comes in and needs accommodations, Professor Linda Anderson works very closely with them to do what needs to be done. Additionally, for veterans, students, Stetson, for the, I believe, the third year in a row, is actually rated as a military-friendly organization. We have well over 60 students on veterans benefits. That doesn't even reflect the full number of veteran students on campus. As the one of the two VA school certifying officials, we're really proud of the fact that we have folks on voc rehab, Chapter 33, 31, and other benefit packages. Additionally, we have our fantastic Veterans Law Institute and Clinic. And Dean, I'd like to talk about that, and then I'm gonna come back to the admissions process, because I do want to talk about how Stetson is inclusive and veterans being a big part of our community. It's important to kind of segue there. So can you talk about the VLI and other programs?
Sure. So the Veterans Law Institute is an umbrella organization that encompasses the Veterans Advocacy Clinic, as well as other parts of it, which includes our director of our Veterans Law Institute is Mike Allen, who has testified in Washington on a number of occasions on veterans issues and is a well-recognized expert in the field. He goes up every year to the Court of Veterans Claims and provides training for the veterans judges. And so we have a very wide breadth of experience that exists with Professor Allen. And Professor Simcox is the director of our Veterans Advocacy Clinic. And one of the things that I'm, one of the things that I'm most proud of is a number of years ago, we established the first in the country medical legal partnership with the University of South Florida's Morsani School of Medicine and the Stetson University College of Law to partner together to represent veterans before the Department of Veterans Affairs and the Court of Veterans Appeals in Washington to help them get the benefits that they deserve based on their service to our country. We know that the length of time that a veteran has to go through before they obtain veterans benefits, particularly if they've first been denied by the Department of Veterans Affairs, is significant. And so we get a chance to work with them to help reduce that time and to help get them the benefits that they deserve. One of the best benefits of this Veterans Advocacy Clinic program is that it does a number of things. One is it helps our community, and it helps our veterans in particular. But internally, it helps us because our lawyers and their doctors, our law students and their medical students, get an opportunity to collaborate and work together on a project that does help the community. And we know what happens when students graduate from law school is that they are not isolated in their offices. They work in teams. They work in collaborative efforts with other professionals and other disciplines, like doctors, to be able to best represent their clients. And so students have the opportunity to directly work with veterans and to provide the representation along with the help of our experts at the University of South Florida to help our veterans obtain something that they otherwise deserve. And so that program is one of the hallmarks, I think, of a Stetson education, of a Stetson experience. And you combine that with the opportunities that people have in advocacy and legal writing. And I think that package together is a big part of why Stetson has been successful.
Thank you, Dean. I'm going to address Natalie and Jess. You all asked some additional questions about the application process. Natalie, you had a question about the personal statement. The personal statement is typically 2 to 3 pages, double spaced, traditional, you know, 1-inch margins. Really, we're looking to see, you know, why you're interested in law. Please tell us maybe a little bit about why Stetson. Perhaps there's a program of interest here and you would like to pursue it. We're looking at, you know, the quality of writing. Are you persuasive? Are you a personal advocate, let's just say? Grammar, syntax, all of those typical things that you'd expect that we would look at. We look at that in the personal statement. And if we can read your handwriting on the LSAT writing sample, you might be surprised to find out that more law schools read it than you think. So if you have yet to take the test, please try to write well on that writing sample. Additionally, Jess, you asked the question about one particular grade and how will one grade among your whole college career really affect you. If you have one weak grade and you did not do grade forgiveness or even did grade forgiveness, I wouldn't really stress too much about it if your GPA is otherwise very strong. If you have a semester of poor grades, a pattern of weak grades, perhaps you had a semester where you should have withdrawn for medical reasons, I would definitely enclose an addendum explaining what happened. But one weak grade, I would not stress yourself out so much that you worry about gaining admission. Just get your apps out there and see what happens. Now, we have a couple of folks who are asking about scholarships, and in the Dean's 5 years here, I will say that one of the things I've been really, really happy about is his efforts to increase our endowment, generate scholarships from our alumni and donors, and increase our commitment to awarding student scholarships, both entering students as well as returning students. And we do a very generous scholarship budget. And I have my stats here, so you have to pardon me for looking down at my book. But the most recent entering class, 76% of our students had some form of scholarship. And once again, Carmen referenced the Standard 509 report. You can actually see a breakdown on there of how schools award scholarships as well as the schools who offer conditional scholarships. And you'll see that Stetson doesn't really have a lot of conditional scholarships. And for those that we do, we have a 100% retention rate. And it's something we're really proud of. But we have a great scholarship budget. Get your stuff in early. We look at your academic record, your undergrad GPA, and your high LSAT score. We're going to scroll down a little bit, and we have a whole lot of questions, and so I want to make sure we get all of you. We have someone who has a question about our campus facilities and our courtrooms. I think that Stetson's facilities are top in the nation. There are a couple of other law schools that might slightly compare, but we really have wonderful facilities and our courtrooms. So Dean, you want to talk a little bit about the courtrooms here at Stetson?
Yeah, let me talk a little bit about the facilities first. So you can see in the background, that is the tower that exists on our campus. And that is, it was a view from a courtyard that you just saw a minute ago. Our facility was built in the early 1920s as a resort hotel that didn't survive the Great Depression, so it existed as a hotel only for a few years. It then became the Florida Military Academy for a number of years. And the College of Law, which is the oldest law school in the state of Florida, was founded in 1900. And in the early 1950s, it moved from our undergraduate campus in DeLand, Florida, which is between Orlando and Daytona on I-4, to our present location here in Gulfport. And so we have tried as much as possible to maintain the original integrity of the campus as was originally built in the 1920s. And so while we have made some additions to our campus, and lots of additions lately to our campus, we have kept the architecture the same as we have as it was built in the 1920s. It's frankly delightful to be able to come to work at a resort hotel that exists on campus in largely the same condition as it was in the 1920s. And so Laura asked about courtrooms. We do have 7 courtrooms that exist on campus. In large part, it is because of our advocacy program. We want to make sure that our students have the facilities that exist that are able to match our program. And one of the things that I often talk with our alumni about as I travel around the state of Florida, as I travel around the country to talk with our alumni about some of the successes that have happened at Stetson, is that we want to build a new building, an advocacy building, that opens up as the entry point to our campus, which will add another 6 courtrooms to our campus for a total of 13. And there's nobody that rivals that number of courtrooms that exists on a law school campus, in large part because we want to make sure that our students not only have the experiences of our advocacy program while they're in law school, but also the experiences of courtroom advocacy while they're still in law school. And so 7 courtrooms on campus is fantastic. But I'd like to double it.
I think that would be wonderful. Okay, so here's what we'd like to do. We have a very short video that Stan Arthur in the background here has helped prepare with one of our students. And we're going to take a quick break to show you that as we kind of organize your questions and get right back at it. So please stay tuned. I think there are about 77 or 78 folks watching, so we'll be right back.
To law school to help people. I'm one of those quintessential kind of people that really want to use my own life in a way of service. I was really between going clinical psych or going to law school, and law school kind of just won it out. I felt that I could affect more people using a law degree than a one-on-one type of clinical practice, so that really influenced me to pursue law school. I wanted to find a university that gave me a holistic education, a well-rounded education. I wanted to be the advocate that had many skills but also retained compassion and humanity, so I really found that at Stetson. Coming from an undergraduate psychology degree, specifically adolescent psychology, and using my law degree together, I thought that that would be the best way to really affect positive and meaningful change. I'm still dreaming and hoping and finding my way, but I definitely want to do something with juveniles. Juveniles really deserve someone that can believe in them, that can take them farther than just what they've experienced, and help them hold on to their resiliency and reach their dreams. My ideal success in my career would be a balanced lifestyle between serving my community, serving youth, showing other advocates that they can have a life of balance and a life of service. That is the type of advocate that I want to be.
Are asking some great questions. This is a lot of fun. I hope you guys are enjoying it as well. So we're going to talk to Ellen Clark. You talked about being a little bit nervous about applying because you don't have any legal internship experience. I would not worry about that at all. That's what law school is for. Dean, did you have any legal experience before you went to law school?
The very short answer to that is no. And they admitted me to law school, and I became a law school dean, so life is good.
Life is good. So, Ellen Clark, I would not worry about that. We the whole point of coming here is that we're going to work with you, make sure you have the skills, make sure you have access to the folks that you need access to in order to get the jobs of your dreams. We'll do all we can, right? And as long as you uphold your end of the bargain. We have over 400 seats in clinics and externships a year that our students can take part in after their first year. So there are plenty of opportunities for you to get hands-on training. Now, we have a lot of questions about the LSAT, and I think there's a little anxiety about it. What tests do we take? Can you retake it? So let's do a quick rundown, and then I'm going to turn it over to the dean. Stetson takes the high score. Your score is viable for 5 years. You are allowed to take the June score. I do want to see you apply in advance of the June score so that we know it's coming. Our deadline is actually May 15th. Now, if demand warrants it, we'll extend the deadline, but don't count on that. So you need to get your application in before May 15th, sooner the better, actually. You can indicate that you're a June tester. All right, now I know a lot of you are waiting on your February scores. I hope it went well this past weekend. If you need to retake June, you probably want to go ahead and think about it soon because I believe the registration is a little earlier this year. Now, we have a lot of folks who put in here, and Carmen, if you don't mind scrolling down, is the application reviewed, is the CAS report viewed prior to the February score coming out? I'm trying to paraphrase. Okay, we will not actually get your CAS report until your score is released. If you submit your application, we'll process it and make sure everything came across okay. Personal statement, resume, the application itself. If we need anything else from you, we'll let you know. Then you're put into sort of a processed status where you're pending. And as soon as your February test score is released, so long as LSAC has your transcripts, you will come to us electronically and we'll get your CAS report. Letters of recommendation as well, we require one. And once we get that CAS and we put it together electronically with your app, you go to committee for review. So we do not actually send you to the faculty committee until we have your file in its complete status. So I really hope that happens. So Dean, do you have any tips or thoughts on the LSAT that you might like to share with the folks out there who are thinking about the June test, maybe how to prepare, that kind of thing?
Well, I think spending some time in a test environment is particularly helpful. So we know that the LSAT test is what is referred to as a speeded test. What that means is if you had more time, more people would be able to figure out the right answers to the questions. But the questions, the way that the LSAT test is set up, is a speeded one. So it's how fast you can process the information. How fast you can process the information in the reading comprehension section and be able to then utilize that to be able to come up with an answer. So many people always say, well, I did a lot better on my practice test. Trying to create the same type of test environment before you take the LSAT test, I think, is most helpful. And LSAC has some free information that's available, some free previous tests that are available on their website. Do those and try to recreate the same environment that you would have for the June test, and I think that would be most helpful.
Thank you.
Sure.
So we had a great question about service work. Stetson is one of the first schools to require pro bono service. So Dean, do you want to talk a little bit about our pro bono service and some, maybe some of the things students have done over time?
Sure. I think as we think about a law school, and what we want to see our graduates do when they graduate from law school is we want them to be good lawyers. But I think most importantly, or perhaps even more importantly, is that we want them to see them to be good leaders in the community. And so Laura is correct. We are one of the first law schools in the country to adopt a pro bono public service requirement. During your law school career, 60 hours of pro bono service as part of your graduation requirements. And my hope is that 60 is not enough for you, that you spend a lot more time in the community trying to help make our communities a better place. So it is delightful every year when I get to see the amount of hours that our students volunteer and contribute back to our community. So last year, about 30,000 hours of pro bono service by our students to our community. Last night, I was over at our Tampa campus, which is about 30 miles or so from our Gulfport campus. And Mayor Buckhorn asked me to do a welcome as part of his Mayor's University. And my welcome essentially was, you know, we are not a law school in Tampa Bay. We are a law school of Tampa Bay. Because if you're in a particular place, that place can be any place. It could be in Portland, it could be in Sacramento, it could be in Philadelphia. But if you're part of a community, if you're of the community, then you are intertwined within the fabric that exists within within the Tampa Bay area. And so we are very proud of our affiliations with Pinellas County here in Gulfport and Hillsborough County in Tampa. And we recognize that we can contribute a lot to making our communities a better place. My hope is that you come to law school by already having that commitment. But certainly my hope is that when you leave law school, that you recognize wherever it is, that it's a privilege to be a lawyer, a privilege that not a lot of people get a chance to have. And most people that can influence where a community goes and their opinions are people that have gone to law school. And so my hope is that you take that with you after you graduate from law school and do your best to make our communities just a little bit better.
Thank you. We have a question about open house events. As a matter of fact, we have an open house event Saturday, February 18th. We're having an event called the Stetson Experience here at our Gulfport campus. And I think if we haven't placed a link to it, Carmen has placed a link already. You're welcome to come. It's a fantastic day. We will have a lot of our different offices represented on campus, our certificates of concentration. Folks will be out there to answer questions, professors, students, everyone's out there basically that day to help you learn more about Stetson and decide whether you want to apply or if you've applied and you're admitted, if Stetson's the right fit for you for your legal education. Now, if you can't make that event and you really want to come see us, we'd love to have you. We have folks visit all the time. We do tours Monday through Friday at noon. If classes are in session, we have classes you can sit in on. We have faculty members, faculty committee members that actually sit down and will talk with you. You can meet with our admissions, financial aid, housing, career development folks. So we'll plan a real nice event for you. Feel free to just call us, email us, or go onto our website. You can fill out a form on there. Next, there's a question about law schools operating in the red. If we can scroll back up to that question, I think the question was that a viewer read that two-thirds of the law schools out there are operating in the red and wondered a little bit more about Stetson. And I'd like to have the dean address that because I know it's something you're familiar with.
Yeah, interestingly, as dean, you get to spend a lot of time with the budget and making sure that the things are going well. So the short answer to the question is that we're not one of the law schools that is operating in the red. I'm delighted that in the 5 years that I've been here, that our budget is sound. It's financially sound as it was, and our projections are for it to continue to be that way long into the future. So I know that there have been major changes in legal education. We're very well aware that the applications to law schools since 2009 have dropped by 30%. And enrollment in law schools nationally has dropped by 30%. That plays a pretty big impact on the budgets of law schools throughout the country. The good news for Stetson is that we figured out how our budget operates. We know how our budget operates. And we're very comfortable with where we are. In large part because we know what outcomes our students have when they graduate from law school. So if you look at that link that Carmen put up a little bit earlier in our webcast with our employment statistics, it tells me that the community is valuing what Stetson produces in terms of its lawyers. And if that continues to happen, as we certainly know it will, then our finances are a place where I'm very confident and very comfortable with where we are and where Stetson will be in the future.
We have have another question about our student organizations, and I believe we have a link that we can put up, and it's already been placed. Stetson actually has 45 different student organizations. A lot of them are extremely active. You know, they go through an ebb and flow kind of thing, but right now we have an amazingly active campus. There's always something happening. If you're coming here from out of state or out of region, and you're worried about getting to know people, there is something here for you. They range. This is actually one of our books. I know it's green. It's falling into the background. You can't actually see it, but the book is green, and we are on a green screen. But it shows you the list. So there is something for everyone, and we have a parent-student organization. A student parent organization. So if you have children and you're coming here, student veterans organizations, healthcare law, women in the law, and on. So it's a very active, engaged student body. And there are activities constantly. So you will meet people and you will make friends. We also have a question about how many hours a day students might spend studying. What's a full-time schedule like, part-time schedule in terms of classroom time as well as out-of-classroom time?
Sure. So let me go. Before I address that one, I want to go back to something that you just said about making friends on campus. So one of the benefits, I think, of being part of the law school at Stetson is that our undergraduate campus is in DeLand, which is about 3 hours from our campus here. And so Stetson itself is in a law school community, which is a residential community that surrounds our campus. And so the good news is that you have 220, 225 or so first-year full-time law school students, as well as another 35 or 40 part-time students. And when you add that up with our international students, you have about 750 or 800 people on campus. In the middle of a residential community, which means that students get to know each other pretty well pretty quickly. We do have dorms on campus. We have an apartment complex that we own that is two blocks away. And we own a number of houses that surround campus. Plus, there are abundant condominiums and townhouses and apartments just across the street from the law school. And so I think one of the best benefits and one of the best decisions you can make about law school is make sure you live close to campus. In large part because it helps increase your the ease for you to be able to participate in all those student organizations that you have been asking about. Okay, so that was my long way of saying something else other than the question. So the question was, how much time do you spend in a first year class? It's 30 hours, 31 hours in the first year over two semesters. You take the traditional courses in your first year of property, contracts, torts, and those types of courses that are the foundation for everything else that happens in law school. And so those are foundational courses. After that, you have lots of choices for the classes that you want to take after that. I think one of the best ways to think about law school is that you put classes after your first year into buckets. These are classes that I want to take, these are classes that I might want to take, and these are classes that don't interest me at all. And once that happens, after your first year, the courses that you probably take include evidence and professional responsibility. But after that, there are 88 credit hours that are necessary to graduate from law school. And we fill up 35 or 38 of those hours, which means that you have lots of flexibility for those types of things that might interest you while you're in law school. You know, I think a kind of a general rule of guidance is for every 1 hour you're in class, you're probably spending 2 hours preparing for it outside of class. I will tell you that we have been doing this as a law school for a long time, which means that we know that when you first come to law school without any experience in legal training, that it takes a little bit longer to read cases, it takes a little bit longer to figure out the analysis, it takes a little bit longer to figure out what the issue is in the case and what the court is trying to decide than it will in your second or third year. And so I think a rough rule of thumb would be probably 2 hours, maybe 3 hours per class, per hour that you're in class. And that's not just spending it by yourself, but it's in collaboration with many of your classmates in study groups trying to put together the information that you just discussed in class. It is stopping by the professor's office and saying, you know, I just walked out of contracts class and it feels like it was torts class. Can you explain a little bit about the concept that we just talked about in the contracts class and about consideration. And so there's lots of different ways that you approach what happens outside of class. But I think a big part of the endeavor is making sure that you devote enough time to be able to do that.
Thank you. We have about 10 minutes left, and I know some of you may have to go back to work or log off, so I'm going to take just a second here to give out an email address so that if you have questions that we didn't get to or didn't answer in the depth that you needed, I'd love to have you email us and request a phone conference or come for a visit. We want to make sure that we do completely answer all of your questions. I'm sure that this webinar has also sparked more interest in some other topics that you hadn't even thought about. So the email that you will use is lawadmit@law.stetson.edu. The whole team checks it, and then we will make sure we get you a response right away. Okay, so we had a couple of questions, and this is what I like to call the rapid fire part of the webinar, where I just kind of answer them real fast. What's the lowest LSAT score we accept? You know, we don't actually have a minimum. What I can tell you is that if somebody comes to us who has a very, very high GPA, a master's degree, a PhD, for example, significant work history, and they have a little bit of a weaker LSAT, we've probably gone as low as about a 147 or so, but I can't say that that would be the lowest that we'd go. Again, it's a holistic file review. And, you know, you just don't know if you're going to be that diamond in the rough, right? I mean, there might be something that you bring to Stetson into legal education, into the profession that we're looking for. So I always say this, before you give up on a school because you don't meet that little box of the 75th, the median, and the 25th percentile, give them a call. Talk with a counselor. Carmen Johnson, Darren Kettles in my office, they can sit down with you and say, look, here are the areas of strength, here are the areas of weakness, here's some tips, some recommendations, or let's develop a strategy together. So take advantage of the fact that law schools have counselors that are there to guide you and help you put your best file forward. The other thing we have is a student had a question about furry friends. And yes, we do have a lot of furry friends on campus. Dean, you want to mention the pets on campus? It's something that we do at exam time, actually.
That's true. There are lots of pets on campus, particularly dogs on campus. We are a very pet-friendly campus. Many of our professors bring their dogs to campus. They stay in their offices. I get to say hello to them every time I walk up and down the faculty hallways. So it is one in which you can see by the background there's a lot of acreage that exists on our campus. And we very much welcome pets that exist on campus, and you'll see lots of them. What Laura was referring to is that during exam time, we have lots of dogs that come on campus and hang out in the library. So if you need a little break from studying, you can walk out, go pet a dog, feel a little bit better, and then go back and study more contracts and torts and criminal law.
We have pet therapy dogs that come by. They're faculty member, students, and alumni dogs. Okay, a couple of other quick ones. What's the tuition price? Currently, the tuition is $41,134 per year. Obviously, half fall, half spring. And tuition pretty much goes up a little bit every year. It's a percentage, very small percentage. And again, about 76% of our entering students receive some form of scholarships. We're very, very proud of that. Okay, we had a couple of questions about the Tampa Law Center. So part-timers, if you're out there and you're thinking about our part-time program, with the part-time program, you will take classes both in Gulfport and in Tampa. Our building is in downtown Tampa, and it is absolutely beautiful. Do you want to tell them a little bit about that building and why it's so special?
Sure. So we have our a satellite campus that exists in Tampa, about 30 miles or so from our Gulfport campus. All of our faculty, about 45 faculty members, are resident in our Gulfport campus. But we also teach some classes in Tampa. So I would guess probably 85%, maybe 90% of our classes are in Gulfport. Probably 15% or so are on our Tampa campus. In part because more of the legal work that happens in the Tampa Bay area happens over by our Tampa campus, and so we have lots of judges and lawyers that teach as part of our program of legal education that exists and teach in our Tampa campus. One of the best benefits for having that campus is that Florida has five courts of appeal, so that the way that our court system is structured. You have trial courts that exist on the state level throughout the state. There are five appellate courts that exist in the state of Florida, and then appeals from those cases, from those five appellate courts, go to the state Supreme Court. The second district court of appeals, so one of the courts of appeal in the state of Florida, sits in our Tampa campus. So our Tampa building is very much structured like the building that you see in our background with the tower. It is about 90,000 square feet of building. The second district court of appeals occupies a little less than half of it. They hear many of their cases on our campus in the William Reese Smith Junior Courtroom. And so many of our students clerk for the judges after they graduate from law school, and they intern with the judges while they're in law school. So one of the best benefits of having the Tampa campus is that we do have a working court that exists and exists on a Stetson campus. And plus, we have access to many of the partners of the major law firms that exist there. We also know that Laura mentioned that we have over 450 or so externships and clinical opportunities for students every year. It's nice to be in the position where we have more spots than students that want them. And so we partner with a little over 60 hosting organizations for our students to work on live cases while they're still in law school. And a big part of that is being able to work with the court on our second DCA, on our campus in Tampa with the Second District Court of Appeals.
We also have a question about the number of courses that students take who are in the part-time program versus the full-time program. Part-timers are typically taking two courses in the fall and spring, one in the summer. Right. The full-timers are typically taking four courses fall, four in the spring, and do not have to attend summer. So part-timers, if you go part-time the whole way through, it's about 4 years. Full-timers, it's a traditional three-year program. Many students do choose to take their experiential opportunities in the summertime, doing their clinics and externships, and maybe even getting a job that pays them money. That would be fun. A lot of students choose to do summers where they work and just take a break. Others may choose to study abroad in the summertime. We have a number of study abroad opportunities. It's something we're very well known for in terms of offering quality study abroad legal education. And we have a whole host of them on our website that you can certainly look at. We only have a few minutes left. I'm looking to see if we have any remaining questions. But one of the things I always like to do when I have the dean is just to see if there are any tips or advice that he might have. So think about a tip or piece of advice. I'm going to see if we have another question up here. Somebody asked about a fee waiver. Yes, if you provided us with an accurate email when you logged in, we will most certainly send you a fee waiver code as a thank you for spending an hour of your day with us. If you're getting ready to apply and you can't find that code, just shoot us an email or give us a call and we'll get that code to you. If you're sitting on your application, you're waiting to apply, you've just been wondering, you know, whether you should just go for it, please get it in. The sooner you get it in, the faster we can get you a decision. You can learn about scholarship opportunities, engage if you get admitted, and admitted students at functions and events. We do a whole host of dinners with the dean, alumni participate in these. So we really encourage folks to apply and really start looking hard at Stetson Law for their future. So Dean, what is one tip or piece of advice that you would offer a prospective student as they embark on this journey?
Oh, I don't only want one.
You can have two.
Can I have more than that?
No, two. No.
All right.
You're the dean. You can have whatever you want.
So I think, number one, if you're thinking about Stetson, come and visit. I think that you're going to be part of a law school community that exists not only for 3 years, but an alumni of that law school after you graduate from law school forever. So come and get a sense about what the place is like. Come in, sit in on a class. Have an opportunity to talk with some faculty members who are on the admissions committee. Have an opportunity to feel like what the culture feels like on campus. One of the other questions that I often get is, how should I prepare for law school? What should I do in the summer before I'm getting ready to show up on campus in August? And the answer to me is that there's nothing specifically other than find ways to sit down for an hour or two and read. One of the ways that law school is a change from undergraduate education is the reading assignments tend to be a little bit longer, and having the ability to be able to discuss those when you come back to class the next day. And so spend some time sitting down, reading. It doesn't matter what it is. If you like fiction, read fiction. If you like autobiographies, read autobiographies. That'll be wonderful preparation to get you ready for law school. I also agree, this is my third one, I know, but I agree with Laura. And that is, if you're thinking about applying to law school, apply early. There's a lot more scholarship money that's available much earlier in the process. Don't be afraid to pick up the phone and call and talk to one of our fabulous people in our admissions office. Laura's great. We've been talking about Carmen in the background. Darren is fabulous. We really do have a great team. So come and visit us and stop by and say hello.
Thank you. And on behalf of everyone at Stetson University College of Law and our alumni, which, by the way, to answer a last minute question, our alumni are all over the country and world. On behalf of all of us, thank you for spending time with us today, and I hope to welcome you someday to the Stetson family. Have a good day.
Thank you for watching Stetson Law Live. For more information, send us an email or give us a call. For your convenience, our contact information will remain on screen for the next few minutes. Be sure to check our homepage often for news, information, and updates. Thanks again. We look forward to hearing from you soon.